Welcome back. This is part three of a probably four-part series on general relativity. It could be a lot longer, trust me. If you haven't seen the first two videos where we're exploring Einstein's thought process that eventually brought us over the course of 7 years to general relativity between the years of 1907 and 1914, you should watch those other two because this is just one of the puzzle pieces of general relativity. If you don't have the other two, this one doesn't make so much sense. So in the first one, we explored the equivalence principle, how inertia and gravitational masses are exactly the same. So a falling object experiences no gravity. And we learned that gravity is acceleration. They are exactly the same. And we learned how special relativity is hiding underneath the surface when we start exploring the nature of gravity, because a free-falling observer experiences no gravity, which means the special relativity applies to them. Now, the third major piece is a little bit harder to visualize. It's another thought experiment courtesy Uncle Albert himself. It's a little bit harder to think about, but it's a very necessary one. And this one is where you imagine something like a merry-go-round. Like, you know, the spinny thing with the horsies that go up and down. Now, imagine you build a particularly weird one where all the horses are perfectly nose to tail. Like, you leave absolutely no gaps on that outer edge where it's horse, 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 all the way around in a circle. Lots of horses. Now, imagine what happens if you're standing on the ground and you spin it up really fast, like not just a little bit, but like close to the speed of light, really, really fast. Well, we know from special relativity that there are two interesting things that happen to objects that move. Moving clocks run slow and moving rulers contract along the length of their motion. So that means if a 1 meter rod is racing by you at close to the speed of light, it will appear to be shorter depending on how fast it goes as it breezes by you. That is an unavoidable thing. It's a part of the relationship between space and time. It's baked into the very mathematics of special relativity. You can't get rid of it. So when we think about this special merry-go-round, as it's going super fast, these horses are going by you. And when they cross in front of you, they're going close to the speed of light because we're really good at building merry-go-rounds. That means they're shorter, which means they're not nose to tail anymore, which means there are gaps when there used to not be gaps. Okay, that's not such a big deal, except when you think about the relationship between the circumference of that merry-go-round and the diameter of the merry-go-round. When it's stationary, it's just a circle. And Euclid told us all about circles, that the circumference of a circle is equal to its diameter times pi. You measure the diameter, multiply by pi, boom, 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 that gives you the amount of circumference. No big deal. But what about this spinning one? You built that circle. You built that circle perfectly, and you had no other choice because you're using, this is this Euclidean geometry, good old high school geometry. Now you accelerate it where the horsies are smaller. There are gaps. The circumference is larger than it used to be. The circumference is not equal to the diameter times pi. It's equal to a bigger number. And the only reason it does that is because it's spinning close to the speed of light. Well, is there any mathematics at all that describes that kind of situation where the circumference of a circle doesn't always equal its diameter? Well, yeah, non-Euclidean geometry. This is a set of geometry developed around the mid-1800s. Relatively forgotten in the decades since then, until Einstein started thinking of these things and he started asking his mathematician buddies, like, hey, I've heard about this like non-Euclidean geometry. Can you tell me more about it? They helped him dig through the literature, work out some of the math. And the mathematics of non-Euclidean geometry is the mathematics of curved objects. Imagine like the surface of the Earth. The surface of the Earth is not flat. The geometry that you learned in high school, the Euclidean geometry, only applies to flat, like here on this table. I can draw triangles and the interior angles of a triangle add up to 180 degrees. I can draw two parallel lines and the parallel lines stay perfectly parallel out into infinity. All the usual stuff. Apply that to the surface of the Earth and different rules apply. If I pick three cities on the surface of the Earth and draw straight lines between them, the interior angles of that triangle that I just made will be greater than 180 degrees. If I draw two parallel lines at the equator, like let's call them lines of longitude, because why not? They at the equator, they start out perfectly parallel, and then the curvature of the Earth will force them to meet at the poles. Parallel lines don't stay parallel. Circles, the circumference doesn't always add up to the diameter times pi. Straight lines aren't always straight. Triangles obey all sorts of weird relations. This is the rules of non-Euclidean geometry of curved surface. And there's the final puzzle piece that Einstein needed to get us general relativity. One puzzle piece is that special relativity, flat space-time, is hiding there under the surface for free fall observers. It's always kind of there. If we always like, you know, we roll back the curtain a little bit and are like, okay, there's special relativity. So space-time is the language we need. Space-time is still the stage. The second thing is that gravity and acceleration seem to be connected and seem to be identical. And then the last is some kind of accelerations, like a spinning merry-go-round, lead to non-Euclidean geometry, aka curved spacetimes. And it was these pieces together that Einstein needed to make general relativity happen, or at least get started. It took him a couple more years to actually work out the mathematics of what this all meant, of how to actually take all these nebulous concepts and codify them to be able to describe how matter and energy relate to the curvature of space-time and how the curvature of space-time relate to the motion of matter. But this is Einstein's picture. Gravity is curvature. Gravity is curvature. The curvature of space-time is what we call gravity. That's his final theory. That is general relativity in a nutshell. And it comes from these thought experiments. Obviously, nowadays it's derived in different ways. We use different techniques and more rigorous mathematics to actually get at the equations of general relativity, but it comes back to these fundamental principles, starting with the equivalence principle, examining it in different scenarios, looking at the effects of rotation, leading us to the conclusion that curvature has something to do with acceleration, acceleration has something to do with gravity, gravity has something to do with space-time. You thread all that together and you get general relativity. So in this picture, all observers, everybody, a beam of light, a rocket ship, astronaut falling out of that rocket ship, it doesn't matter. All want to follow straight lines. They all do. But the space-time underneath them is warped and they're forced to follow different trajectories. And these different trajectories are what we call gravity. It's the bending of space-time itself. So how does it do it? Like, how does space-time bend in the presence of matter or energy? I don't know if that's the right question. Because under general relativity, the presence of matter or energy is the bending of space-time. How does the bending of space-time alter trajectories and cause acceleration? Well, the bending of space-time is gravitational acceleration. They're the same thing. They're connected through these very fundamental assumptions about the way the universe works. That is general relativity. That is our modern picture. And it's such a unique viewpoint. It's really hard to argue. it's really, really, really hard. If we lived in a universe without Einstein, it's doubtful that anyone would have come up with general relativity. Because at the time, special relativity, yeah, there were other people thinking along similar lines. In fact, Einstein took a lot of the existing mathematics, he just gave it a different twist, a new interpretation. So someone else would have figured out special relativity. But general relativity? That's all Einstein, man. That's just him. And it's doubtful if even today, in the 21st century, we would have this picture of gravity if it weren't for Einstein. And it was his thought experiments connected to his extreme perseverance and mathematical agility and competence that gave us this. Next time, I'm going to talk about how we test this fantastic idea of general relativity, that gravity is curvature. But that's next time. Hope you enjoyed. If you like this video, feel free to hit the like button and also subscribe and do the notification thing and go to patreon.com/PM Sutter to help me help you wrap our minds around general relativity. See you next time.